Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for standing by for the third quarter 2024 earnings conference call for XPeng Inc. At this time, all participants are in listen-only mode. After management's remarks, there will be a question-and-answer session. Today's conference call is being recorded. I'll now turn the call over to your host, Mr. Alex Xie, Head of Investor Relations and Capital Markets of the company. Please go ahead, Alex.
Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome to XPeng's third quarter 2024 earnings conference call. Our financial and operating results were issued via Newswire services earlier today and available online. You can also view the earnings press release by visiting the IR section of our website at ir.xiaopeng.com. Participants on today's call from our management will include our Co-founder, Chairman, and CEO, Mr. He Xiaopeng, Vice Chairman and President, Dr. Brian Gu, Vice President of Corporate Finance and VW Projects, Mr. Charles Zhang, Vice President of Finance Accounting, Mr. James Wu, and myself. Management will begin with prepared remarks, and the call will conclude with a Q&A session. A webcast replay of this conference call will be available on the IR section of our website. Before we continue, please note that today's discussion will contain forward-looking statements made under the Safe Harbor provisions of the U.S. Private Securities Litigation Reform Act of 1995. Forward-looking statements involve inherent risks and uncertainties. As such, the company's results may be materially different from the views expressed today. Further information regarding these and other risks and uncertainties is included in the relevant public filings of the company as filed with the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission. The company does not assume any obligation to update any forward-looking statements except as required under applicable law. Please also note that XPeng's earnings press release and this conference call include the disclosure of unaudited GAAP financial measures as well as unaudited non-GAAP financial measures. XPeng's earnings press release contains a reconciliation of the unaudited non-GAAP measures to the unaudited GAAP measures. I will now turn the call over to our Co-founder, Chairman, and CEO, Mr. He Xiaopeng. Please go ahead.
Hello, everyone. I'm He Xiaopeng. In the third quarter of 2024, we surpassed our key performance targets. We delivered 46,533 units in the third quarter, reflecting a 54% increase quarter-over-quarter and a 16% increase year-over-year, beating the high end of our prior quarterly guidance. September's deliveries exceeded 20,000 units, marking a record high. Furthermore, thanks to the technology-driven cost reduction and growth in scale, our gross profit margin increased to 15.3% in the third quarter, achieving our pinnacle level and demonstrating continuous improvement for five consecutive quarters.
同时小鹏对于 AI 技术的坚定投入正在开始转变成更好的产品体验，更好的成本优势，它使我们的长板更长。那么我们也围绕着客户导向、经营导向和全局思维，正在建立小鹏的 XPD， 也就是从产品研发、测试、供应链到预售、上市、交付等全链条的更一致化，能够确保将来的规模化跟体系化，能够持续打造一款接着一款给用户带来更大惊喜的明星爆品。
Over the past 2 years, XPeng has undergone significant transformation amidst challenges. However, I remain calm at the center of the storm because crises often present opportunities. Having overcome these adversities, XPeng has emerged stronger than ever. We're now poised to accelerate our growth and move forward steadily. I would like to express my gratitude to all of our shareholders and everyone who has consistently supported us. We have implemented comprehensive changes in our strategies, products, management, and organizational structure. We've also addressed previous areas of improvement in marketing, sales channels, and design. Moreover, our firm investment in AI technology has begun to yield advantages in both product experience and cost efficiency, helping to bolster our competitive edge. By prioritizing customer needs, maintaining a business-oriented approach, and keeping the full picture in mind, we have established a robust capability across our entire operations, from product definition and research and development to pre-sale activities, product launches, and delivery. As a result, we have created a series of standout products that truly surprise and delight our users.
从今年开始，已经是小鹏的第二个十年的创业。我也相信未来的十年一定是 AI 的时代，所以我会带领小鹏汽车成为面向全球的 AI 汽车公司来坚定的努力，并引领 AI 在出行领域的大规模应用。从整个行业的发展格局来看，我认为未来的三年，也就是2025到2027年，会是中国汽车行业的淘汰赛阶段。一方面，中国新能源汽车渗透率我认为会势不可挡地提升到85%甚至以上。另一方面，我也相信 AI 的变革会驱动整个市场份额会走向下一个阶段的再次整合。那么在过去，我们看到传统的车企的整车研发大部分是依赖于供应链的合作跟集成，而在 AI 汽车领域里面，必须有深度且还要有广度的全站自研能力，它会成为行业竞争的胜负手。那么我们会以 AI 的高强度算力为数据引擎，来整合汽车包括 AD 座舱、底盘、动力等多方面的硬件和软件研发，用更极致的速度迭代升级。那么这会让我们在体验的快速跟强力优化的基础上，还能够更大的加大跟传统研发模式的企业有代际的差距。所以我相信从2025年开始，小鹏无论是在自动驾驶还是在整车的智能，都会看到巨大的跳变。我相信 AI 的大模型会带来多个角度的颠覆性的体验跟变革，会让更多的用户从原来观察到主动拥抱更加安全、舒适、跟全面聪明的 AI 汽车。
XPeng's second decade has started, and I believe the next 10 years will be the era of AI or artificial intelligence. I'll strive to lead XPeng to become a global AI-defined car company and spearhead the large-scale application of AI in the mobility industry. Looking at the industry landscape, I anticipate that between 2025 and 2027, which is upcoming 3 years, we'll see a knockout phase in the Chinese automobile industry. The penetration rate of China's new energy vehicles will likely rise to over 85%, while the integration of AI will lead to the next stage of consolidation of market shares. Unlike the traditional car companies that have relied on cooperative integrated supply chain models for research and development in the past, winners in the AI-defined car sector will be those with in-depth full-stack self-development capabilities. We plan to harness the power of AI and use it as a data engine, integrated both software and hardware in our research and development of the whole vehicle, AD, cabin, and engines, etc. This will allow us to iterate and upgrade at an unprecedented speed, creating a substantial advantage over companies that continue to use traditional R&D models regarding user experience and optimization speed. Starting next year, I expect significant advancement in autonomous driving and vehicle intelligence. Introducing AI large models will provide a transformative experience from all aspects, enabling users to embrace safer, more comfortable, more comprehensive, and smarter AI driving and AI-driven vehicles.
在11月7日，我们的全球首款的AI汽车P7加正式上市。 那么当晚我们的大型车辆超过了3万，而且在现在还在持续的攀升中。那么P7加已经成为中大型纯电轿车市场的一个非常明显的现象级爆款。我欣喜地看到，在整个全系标配高阶自驾，是用户选择P7加的核心原因。 要知道，过去的豪华我们都认为是配置上的豪华。我认为现在越来越多的车是走向了科技豪华，而这也正是小鹏汽车正在努力的方向。我们正在与供应商一起扩大P7加的产能，我期待P7加的交付量在今年的12月份可以达到1万台以上。目前 M03和P7加都已经开启了双班的生产模式。我相信，随着产能的爬坡，在第四季度，小鹏预计月交付量将会再创新高。当然了，我们首先会努力在11月份超过3万台的月销。我们都知道，行稳致远是小鹏在2024年下和2025年的主旋律之一。我们会在2025年 会带着数万的在手订单进入2025年的第一季度，所以我相信这会让我们在明年第一季度交付量更加的稳健，并且为明年的销量大幅度增长打下一个很扎实的基础。
On November 7th, the world's first AI-defined car, the P7 Plus, was officially launched. That night, the number of firm orders exceeded 30,000 and continued to rise. The P7 Plus has become a phenomenal success in the mid-to-large BEV sedan market and marks a milestone in the widespread adoption of AI-defined cars. I'm pleased to see that the core reasons users choose the P7 Plus is its standard, high-standard, intelligent driving features across the entire model range. In the past, luxury was defined by configuration, but now it is defined by technology, and this trend is where we are striving to be. We're collaborating with suppliers to expand the production capacity of the P7 Plus, and I expect the delivery volume of the P7 Plus to exceed 10,000 units in December. Currently, both the M03 and the P7 Plus have begun double shift production. As production capacity ramps up, we anticipate monthly deliveries will set a record in the fourth quarter and will strive to exceed 30,000 units in November. Additionally, steady and long-term progress is one of our main themes for 2025. We'll enter 2025 with tens of thousands of orders, which will increase our delivery volume in the first quarter of next year and lay a solid foundation for a significant increase in sales next year.
From P7加开始，那么我们之后的全新的Max版本车型和改款都会采用国内唯一不依赖高精地图和激光雷达的 AI鹰眼NGP自驾方案，那么在不远的将来，我们还会把它到全球。我相信，在全球的汽车行业内，小鹏率先使用高等级的自驾软硬件成为全系的标配，并且把体验做到领先，而不仅仅在宣传口号里边。我们期望用 Level 2 的成本，达到对标 Level 3 的体验，实现科技平权、油质同价。 那么，在明年春节后的上半年，随着 Mola M03 的 Max 也会进行量产，并且把平台化的 NGP 方案落地，我们将是全球首个把高等级自驾的门槛降到15万这个级别，也就是2万美金的这个级别的车企。 所以小鹏汽车将会同时具备领先的AI自驾能力和极致的成本控制能力。我相信这是竞争对手难以复制的优势，也是我们从血海游到蓝海的杀手锏之一。
Starting from the P7 Plus model, our new and facelifted Max models will all feature the AI Hawkeye visual ADAS solution. This is the only ADAS solution in China that does not rely on HD maps or LiDAR. And we'll take it to the rest of the world soon. In the global automotive industry, we're the first to standardize high-level intelligent driving software and hardware across our entire lineup, providing an actual leading experience for the users. We delivered experience of the level 3 ADAS driving at the cost of level 2, achieving what we refer to as intelligence for all, tech-powered driving with the same cost as fuel. Excitingly, in the first half of next year, after the Lunar New Year, Mona M03 Max will start mass producing the platform-based AI Hawkeye visual ADAS solution. This will allow us to become the world's first car company to offer advanced intelligent driving vehicles for just 150,000 RMB, or about $20,000, lowering the threshold. With our leading AI technology and strong cost control, we have the competitive moat that will serve as our ultimate weapons for navigating from a fiercely competitive red ocean to the opportunities of a blue ocean market.
AI 汽车也就是具备强AI能力、强自动驾驶能力的汽车 将会加速替代这些不具备这样能力的汽车，包括那些只是拥有可宣传的能力，但是并实际体验不佳的汽车，一样会被取代。那么到2025年，小鹏计划推出至少四款新车，并且包括首次推出的超级电动版本的新车型。除此之外，我们还将推出多个车型的改款。 那么我相信这些新车型跟改款，在各自细分市场都会做得更加有特色。我期待明年会推出更多爆款和让用户喜爱的车。
I believe that over the next 1 to 5 years, the penetration rate of smart features will significantly increase non-linearly. Our AI-defined vehicles, which incorporate powerful AI capabilities and autonomous driving features, will accelerate the replacement of cars that lack these technologies or cars that only claim to have these technologies. In 2025, we plan to launch at least 4 new models, including super electric vehicles, and will also update several existing models. Each of these new and facelift models will be very distinctive in their respective market segments, and I look forward to launching more top-selling models that users will love next year.
在最近的小鹏AI科技日上，我们发布了鲲鹏超级电动体系。 什么是超级电动，也就是下一代增程。我们相信小鹏的超级电动跟我们的下一代纯电技术放在一起，将会是我们的第二大增长引擎。它会和我们的AI引擎一起驱动我们加速发展在全球快速发展的强劲势头。那么我们知道动力技术跟能耗领先一直是小鹏在纯电品牌上的标签。 我们有非常多的用户称赞我们是反向虚标、能耗管理之王。同样，我们在下一代我们的超级电动，我们也会用领先市场一代的高压纯电技术来解决当前普通增程解决方案的用户痛点，并提高用户体验。那么，鲲鹏的超级电动会使用第三代的800伏高压系统，做到纯电续航430公里。 做到1400公里的综合续航，5C超级快充，以及诸多特性，并且还保持优秀的成本控制。我相信这会引领下一代增程技术的变革。那么在未来的时间里面，小鹏汽车会采用一车双能的方式，面向全球，也包括中国的需求，推出一批支持纯电和超电的新车。 我相信一车双能将会加速AI汽车在全球的普及速度，也为小鹏带来数倍的销量增长。
At our recent AI Tech Day, we unveiled the XPeng Super Electric System, our next-generation extended range products, along with our next-generation pure electric products, will be our second largest growth engine. Together with our AI capabilities, it will drive strong momentum for accelerated development. Powertrain technology and industry-leading energy efficiency are key components of XPeng's brand. We have received widespread user acclaim for our exceptional energy consumption management, with our electric vehicles regularly exceeding advertised range estimates. In our brand new extended range products, we'll employ high-voltage electric technology one generation ahead of the market to address common user pain points facing current extended range products on the market and provide a user experience far superior to many existing extended range products. The XPeng Super Electric Drive System is built on our third generation industry-leading 800 volts platform, supporting various features including a pure electric range of 430 kilometers, a combined range of 1,400 kilometers, and the 5C ultra-charging battery, while also controlling cost, all of which will lead the way for the next generation extended range technology. In the coming future, XPeng will adopt a dual energy approach, offering a batch of new vehicle models with pure electric and super electric powertrain options to cater to the diverse needs of global customers. I believe that this will significantly expand our total addressable market, bringing multiple opportunities for sales growth and accelerating the mass adoption of AI-defined vehicles worldwide.
那么在经营的方面呢, PG家会成为小鹏全新一代车型在毛利率整体改善的全新的起点。那么在2025年、2026年的全新的车型和重要的改款, 都会搭载PG加以及后面不断发布的系列平台化的新技术。我们期待新一代车型的稳态的毛利率能够达到双位数的水平，并且支持小鹏在大产品周期里面不光能够对销量目标不断的冲击新的高度，而且更好的走向规模的盈利。
In terms of operations, the P7 Plus will also mark a brand new starting point for the overall improvement in vehicle gross margins for XPeng's next generation models. New platform-based technologies we have implemented in the P7 Plus will also be applied to new models and major facelifts over the next 2 years of 2025 and 2026. We anticipate that the gross margin of our next generation models will reach double digits, significantly increasing our sales volume to a new level during our strong product cycles and helping us move steadily toward achieving scale profitability.
那么谈一谈AI自驾, 小鹏的图灵AI自驾, 我们宣布并实现从云端到车端, 从软件到硬件, 甚至到芯片的全站自研, 我相信这会引领下一代 全站自研的技术路线，我看到的市场上很多的友商是停留在小鹏的上一代的大模型的架构。我认为，自驾的将来的能力在云端、在数据、在算力等多个范围，小鹏云端大模型的参数量会是车端的80倍。我认为这代表中国自驾最领先的水平，它使之后自动驾驶的上限 和下限都有数十倍能力的提高的潜力，在今后几年，我们继续会在算力、数据、模型和自动驾驶的下限跟全球化方面迅速扩大。我相信，在 Skynode的驱动下，自动驾驶会在未来的1到5年实现质的数十倍能力的飞跃。
AI smart driving system demonstrates our robust full-stack self-development capabilities. It integrates cloud-based and in-vehicle software and hardware, including chips. It sets a new gold standard for next-generation full-stack development and highlights our exceptionally efficient R&D iteration process. Many of our peers are still using our previous generation of architecture and technological routes. I believe that enhancing the capabilities of smart driving relies heavily on cloud technologies. Our cloud-based large model has 80 times more parameters than the in-vehicle model, making it the most advanced technology currently available in China's ADAS market. In the coming years, the synergy between our in-vehicle data, cloud-based computing power, and both cloud and in-vehicle large models, and our globalization and car manufacturing will grow exponentially, marking and making significant leaps forward in our large models' performance per the scaling law.
在今年底的天玑 5.5 版本上，我们计划用一套端到端的 NGP 打通从车位到车位的全场景，这会让自驾的整体体验开始迈入全新的台阶。实际上，在三年前，小鹏就已经能够基础打通车位到车位，但是那是我们在不同的场景用不同的规则能力进行的衔接，但是从小鹏的 5.5 开始是用一套软件。 那么我相信 5.5 会让小鹏的试驾从原来第一梯队不相伯仲的友商之间的水准，比如说都是 50到60分之间，会跨越到超越原来的 5、60分，到达真正的全面性的第一。我相信小鹏计划在 2025年四季度实现，在当前硬件下做到类似 L3的试驾体验。 也就是我们期望能够做到百公里效率接管在一次左右。我们正在研发的更高阶的 OCR 版本的车型，还会大幅度提高车端算力，并且在核心的整车的部件体系里面加入全冗余的设计，让成本足够低且足够安全的前装量产 Robotaxi 成为更大的可能。我相信，在自动驾驶能力的巨大提升，会让 AI 能力 在之后加速成为头部车企更大差异化竞争的核心能力，并且占领用户心智。那么在那个时候，用户会发现 AI 不仅仅代表自动驾驶，还会在整车的座舱 AI 的助理 AI 的 HUD 智能的底盘、智能的音响 AI 的电磁医生等多项 AI 能力都会带来巨大的差异化的这种差异。 那么那个时候 AI 的领先者跟落后者在科技、品牌、产品、技术盈利模式上将会拉开越来越巨大的、越来越大的差距。We
plan to realize door-to-door full scenario ADAS on Tianji AI XOS 5.5 by the end of this year. This uninterrupted and ultra-smooth driving experience will elevate us from being on par with the first tier to truly leading the pack. We actually were able to deliver similar experience 3 years ago already, but it was a combination of multiple solutions, whereas this 5.5 OS is one-stop solution. Next, we plan to achieve a L3-like intelligent driving experience by the fourth quarter of 2025, targeting less than one takeover per 100 kilometers. The more advanced ultra version of the vehicle we're developing now will significantly enhance the computing power on board and incorporate a fully redundant design for core components. This will enable us to mass produce robo-taxi at a low cost while ensuring sufficient safety. I firmly believe that the substantial improvement in autonomous driving capabilities will make AI a core differentiator among leading automaking companies and a key factor in capturing user mindshare. Users will discover that AI is not only applied to autonomous driving, but will also expand and integrate into various aspects, including in-car AI assistance, AI cabin, AR hub, smart chassis, smart audio systems, and AI battery doctors. In the medium to long term, the gap between AI leaders and laggards on product technology, brand image, and profit models will continue to widen.
我们正在从中国加速走向全球，而且我们相信，在中国智能电动车的出海征程中间，小鹏是绝对的一马当前。我们在过去的两年，我们在组织管理、产品规划、自动驾驶、智能座舱、供应链、生产制造，都不断的在考虑如何进行全球化的战略部署，并且我们和 优质的经销商合作，在三季度，小鹏的海外销售网络已经拓展到了30个国家和超过110家的门店，并且我们在多个国家都取得了很好的开门红。那么，小鹏汽车在中国品牌高端纯电车型目前出口销量占排名是第一的。 我们的小鹏G9在北欧中大型纯电SUV也是排名第一的。在第三季度，我们的海外销量整体环比增长70%，并且占到了公司销量的15%。 那么在2025年，我们计划将我们的销售网络进一步扩展到北美以外超过 90% 的新能源市场，并且超过 300家门店。我们的目标是海外销量在未来的三年保持高速增长势头，在中国车企的新能源中高端出口销量中间要做到第一。国际业务的快速发展也会对我们的盈利改善和产生更大的贡献。
Now let's talk about globalization. We're accelerating our global presence, leading the way for Chinese smart EV brands in their overseas ventures. Our organizational management, product planning, autonomous driving technology, smart cockpit design, supply chain management, and manufacturing and production are all strategically aligned for global deployment. By collaborating with high-quality overseas dealers, we have extended our reach to more than 30 countries, with over 110 sales stores as of the third quarter. And we have experienced strong initial sales in multiple regions. Currently, XPeng ranks first in export sales of Chinese premium BEVs, and our G9 ranks first in the mid to large size battery electric SUV in Northern Europe. In the third quarter, our overall overseas sales increased by 70% sequentially, accounting for 15% of our total sales volume. Looking ahead to 2025, we plan to further expand our international sales network to more than 300 stores, expanding to over 90% of the NEV market outside of North America. Our goal is to maintain robust growth in overseas sales over the next 3 years, aiming to secure the leading position in mid to high-end NEV export sales among Chinese automakers. The rapid expansion of our international business will further boost our profitability.
走过两年的逆风期，我相信小鹏即将进入到全新的正循环的阶段。那么在从2020，并且我们相信我们在2025年的四季度还会开始进入到发展更快速的顺风期，加速成长并且走向盈利。我们预期2024年第四季度的总交付数量约为87,000至91,000辆。 环比上升44.6%到53.3%，收入预计约为人民币153至162亿元，环比上升51.5%至64.4%，同比上升47.2%至24.1%。同时，我们预计第四季度 现金流将会大幅度改善，实现下半年的自由现金流转正。我们在手的现金在今年底预计将会回到400亿的水平，使我们更健康的毛利和现金流，让我们更有底气、更坚定地投入研发跟未来。我相信会为中国跟全球的消费者提供技术更领先一代的AI。
After 2 years of headwinds, we're about to enter a brand new positive cycle. In the fourth quarter of 2025, we expect to experience tailwinds driven by AI transformation and the super electric system, which will accelerate our growth and lead us toward profitability. We anticipate our total delivery volume for the fourth quarter of 2024 will range from 87,000 to 91,000 units. This represents a quarter-over-quarter increase of 87% to 95.6% and a year-over-year increase of 44.6% to 51.3%. Additionally, we project our total revenue for the fourth quarter to fall between 15.3 billion RMB and 16.2 billion RMB, reflecting a quarter-over-quarter rise of 51.5% to 60.4% and a year-over-year increase of 17.2% to 24.1%. Moreover, we expect our cash flow in the fourth quarter to improve significantly, resulting in positive free cash flow for the second half of the year. By year end, we anticipate our cash on hand will exceed 40 billion RMB. With healthier gross profit and cash flow, we'll have the capacity to invest deeply in research and development for the future, allowing us to consistently and confidently provide our customers in China and abroad with market-leading AI-defined vehicles.
谢谢大家。好，下面由我们的财务VP James 为大家介绍小鹏 2024年 第三季度的财务状况。
Thank you, everyone. With that, I'll turn the call over to our VP of Finance, James, to discuss our financial performance for the third quarter of 2024.
Thank you, Xiaopeng. Now let me provide a brief overview of our financial results for the third quarter of 2024. I'll reference RMB only in my discussion today, unless otherwise stated. Our total revenues were 10.1 billion for the third quarter of 2024. An increase of 18.4% year-over-year and an increase of 24.5% quarter-over-quarter. Revenues from vehicle sales were 8.8 billion for the third quarter of 2024, representing an increase of 12.1% year-over-year and an increase of 29% quarter-over-quarter. The year-over-year and quarter-over-quarter increases were mainly attributable to higher deliveries. Revenues from services and others were 1.31 billion for the third quarter of 2024, representing an increase of 90.7% year-over-year and an increase of 1.1% quarter-over-quarter. The year-over-year increase was mainly attributable to the increased revenue from the technical R&D services related to the platform and software strategic technical collaboration, as well as electrical electric architecture, also known as EEA, technical collaboration with the Volkswagen Group. The quarter-over-quarter increase was mainly attributable to the revenue from technical R&D services related to the EEA technical collaboration with the Volkswagen Group, partially offset by the reduction in parts and accessory sales. Gross margin was 15.3% for the third quarter of 2024, compared with negative 2.7% for the same period of 2023 and 14% for the second quarter of 2024. Vehicle margin was 8.6% for the third quarter of 2024, compared with negative 6.1% for the same period of 2023 and 6.4% for the second quarter of 2024. The year-over-year increase was primarily attributable to the cost reduction and the improvement in product mix. The quarter-over-quarter increase was mainly attributable to the cost reduction. R&D expenses were 1.63 billion for the third quarter of 2024, representing an increase of 25.1% year-over-year and an increase of 11.3% quarter-over-quarter. The year-over-year and quarter-over-quarter increases were mainly due to higher expenses related to the development of new vehicle models as the company expanded its product portfolio to support future growth. SG&A expenses were 1.63 billion for the third quarter of 2024, representing a decrease of 3.5% year-over-year and an increase of 3.8% quarter-over-quarter. The year-over-year decrease was primarily due to lower employee compensation in the third quarter of 2024, while the quarter-over-quarter increase was mainly due to higher commissions paid to the franchise stores. As a result of the foregoing, loss from operations was 1.85 billion for the third quarter of 2024, compared with 3.16 billion for the same period of 2023 and 1.61 billion for the second quarter of 2024. Net loss was 1.81 billion for the third quarter of 2024, compared with 3.89 billion for the same period of 2023 and 1.28 billion for the second quarter of 2024. As of September 30th, 2024, our company had cash and cash equivalents, restricted cash, short-term investments, and time deposits in total of 35.75 billion. To be mindful of the length of our earnings call, I would encourage listeners to refer to our earnings press release for more details on our third quarter 2024 financial results. This concludes our prepared remarks. We'll now open the call to questions. Operator, please go ahead.
Thank you. If you wish to ask a question, please press star 1 on your telephone and wait for your name to be announced. If you wish to cancel your request, please press star 2. If you're on a speakerphone, please pick up the handset to ask your question. For the benefit of all participants on today's call, if you wish to ask your question to management in Chinese, please immediately repeat your question in English. For the sake of clarity and order, please ask one question at a time. Management will respond, and then feel free to follow up with your next question. Your first question comes from Tim Hsiao with Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
管理层你好，感谢接受我的提问。那也恭喜公司三季度业绩表现亮眼，然后四季度的这个交付持续强劲增长。我有两个问题，第一个问题是有关于智驾，就是刚才小鹏总也在也分享了。那如果时间维度稍稍拉长，想请教管理层，智驾在未来三到五年之后，这个差异化您觉得是会放大还是会缩小？因为我们也看到国内这个电车的龙头企业考虑全系的车型标配智驾。 那虽然头部企业短期的智驾能力是大幅领先，但一旦智驾达到一定程度的规模化以及普及化，那竞争是否又会回归到这个比拼极致的性价比？那小鹏的技术领先如何让车主不仅有感，而且能够影响他们的这个购车决策？这是第一个问题。So
my first question is about autonomous driving. Because in the next 2 to 5 years, are you expecting the technology gap of smart driving be widened or narrow? Several leading local EV brands in China considering making smart driving a standard configuration for all mass market models. Will autonomous driving become a me-too function in the future? And how could XPeng ensure consumers can feel and appreciate the difference and choose XPeng's cars because of that? That's my first question. Thank you.
对，谢谢，非常好的问题啊。说实话，我们在最近两年端到端大模型的架构思考中间都会经常围绕这个问题。首先，我认为端到端大模型之后会导致的智驾的门槛会提高，因为需要更多的钱、更多的算力、更多的数据啊，才有可能。那么在很多的领域，比如说中国全球，这些都是新的门槛。 那么同时，我认为3到5年里面，从我们的角度，它会使不光是软件加简单硬件的全域全栈自研要到，我们现在的自动驾驶4个领域，从云端到车端，从芯片端到电器端EA架构都需要到全域自研，并且跨汽车的其他的。所以，第一个我认为。 全域自研的广度在提高，使它的能力会变化。那么这是第一个的变化，我认为它的差距会放大。第二个就是，仅仅在自动驾驶，我们认为自动驾驶是等于是汽车的小脑。我们认为在小脑的领域里面，会出现宣传的可用跟真实的好用，可能会有100倍到数万倍的差距。 这是在未来的1到2年里面，我认为这一个是会是质的改变，自动驾驶，这是第二点。第三点当然还有将来整车包括整车大脑更聪明的汽车的一整套的逻辑。所以我认为3到5年智驾会进一步加大对客户体验的影响深度，会让头部会有更强的规模化效应。谢谢。
Thank you. This is a very good question. Actually, we've been talking about this for the past 2 years while we are developing our end-to-end large model solution. Now, what we need here for this next generation of capability is not only, first of all, the capital for R&D, but also the computing power and big data as well. And in the coming 3 to 5 years, I think any companies who try to compete in this land in this landscape will not only have the full-stack self-developed R&D capability that combines software and hardware, but also on the cloud side, whole vehicle, chip development, and also EEA development across different car manufacturing capabilities are all essential for having that capability. So in sum, I believe that the gap between different EV makers will actually be widened in the several years. Another point that I would like to mention is that ADAS capability is just like part of your brain. You have to not only have your mindset, you know, what you think you can do, but you actually need to be able to deliver your claims. And that also will set the bar or the threshold for entering this competition. Another point that I would like to mention is the whole vehicle capability. How do we make sure that the whole car gets smarter in order to carry all this ADAS capability? So I think going forward, users will actually have a better idea or awareness of how capable a company is, how good the product is, and they will have an in-depth experience or first-hand experience of what truly means to have a smart ADAS capability in the product. Thank you.
那么我补充一小段，就是在原来的自动驾驶可以用 Tier 1 和整车厂进行 PK 的情况下，在刚才所说的从小老到大老到整车全部躯体都可以用 AI 驱动的情况下， Tier 1 是不可能 把全域的 AI 都做了，如果做了，它就等于是一个整车厂。所以 Tier 1 在未来的3到4年里面，我认为会迅速的会有整个行业的变化。啊，这补充一下，谢谢。
I also would like to add that traditionally, the model for OEMs to develop cars is to work with Tier 1 suppliers. However, in the future, when we require cars to adapt the ADAS capability from not only the brain, but your upper torso and your legs and the whole body, it will actually require a completely different model of development, which will also, in the coming 3 to 4 years, set us apart from the rest of the competition. Thank you.
感谢小鹏总的补充。那我想第二个问题是有关于盈利能力，因为我们也看到了，就是小鹏汽车过去几个季度，不论是新车或其他的毛利率，都有明显的改善。所以展望明年的话，也想了解一下，就是小鹏汽车如何进一步的收窄亏损，然后以及进一步达到转亏为盈的一个目标。My second question is about the profitability. Because over the past few quarters, we've seen XPeng posting consecutive margin improvement at both vehicle and at the group level. Looking to next year, how could the company further narrow the loss and systematically turn the profit? That's my second question. Thank you.
Hey, Tim, it's Brian. Yeah, let me address this question. First of all, I think in this quarter's financials, I think we're very encouraged to see that our non-GAAP operating margin, actually the loss has narrowed to 15.5% compared to in the second quarter, I think it's about 19%. So you start to see operating leverage, narrowing of our operating losses. And I think that trend will continue. As we mentioned, that we're going to launch P7 Plus, which we think is actually a better margin profile product. And also overall, we actually can see the scale effect coming to play, as well as additionally, we can see continued improvement on the vehicle margin front. And also on the expense side, I think we start to see very significant reduction opportunities. For example, for the fourth quarter, I think we are going to hold a very consistent R&D spend below 2 billion RMB in total, and that will make our entire year's R&D to be probably less than 6.5 billion RMB, lower than our original estimate. So going into next year, we start to see these factors going to compound with additional launch of more robust products. As we mentioned, we have new models as well as refresh models to be launched. We also have models that's tackling new segments, including, for example, extended range energy module. So with all that, I think we're very optimistic about our robust growth as well as continued margin improvement. We still, I think, hold the same view as I think communicated to all of you starting 2 years ago, that we'll be breaking even at some point next year, probably towards the end of next year, and that is still a view I hold. I think we hope to deliver on that. And also the improvement also will bring a healthy cash flow for the company as well next year. So for example, by the end of this year, we estimate we're going to have over 4 billion RMB on hand. And next year, 40 billion RMB on hand, sorry. Next year, I think we will actually still continue to see healthy cash flow, which allows us to have very comfortable capital base to bring us to break even.
Great. Thanks for sharing the details and congrats again on the strong results. Thank you.
Thank you. Your next question comes from Ming Shun Li with Bank of America. Please go ahead.
小鹏总还有各位领导，你们好，我是Ming。 那我这边的第一个问题呢，是关于这个海外的出海。那刚才在会议上，其实小鹏总已经提到，明年我们的海外的这个经销体系会有一个更大幅的增长。那但是也想了解一下，就是说我们怎么看待，就是明年这个海外的这个销量对于我们的贡献。那另外也想请教一下，像我们现在的这个纯电的话，在很多海外市场不晓得，就是有没有看到，因为他们这个充电设施可能没有像国内一样这么的完善，所以说纯电车这边还是有时候会遇到一些销售的瓶颈。那会不会将来我们这个等到我们这个发了这个增程之后，真的产品也会成为我们一个主力的一个销售的产品？那我翻译一下我的问题。 So my first question is related to export outlook. So in 2024, how do you expect the export sales contribution to your total revenue? And currently, because some overseas market, the charging infrastructure is not as good as China. In China, therefore, do you see any potential bottleneck for the EV penetration in certain countries? And in the longer term, will you see your EREV product to be the major product for the overseas market?
Hey, Ming, it's Brian again. Let me address your question on overseas market. First of all, I think we do see overseas market as a very robust growth market for us. It's still very early in the electrification process compared to the Chinese market. And also, I think given our current coverage of covering most of these markets by the end of next year, I think we are hoping to be able to tap into that growth. As you mentioned, this year, our overseas market percentage has increased to around 15% of our sales. I think the next year we expect the contribution will be similar, even though our domestic market growth is very, very significant. But we still think overseas growth will, I think has a very similar growth profile as well. And then also in terms of the electric BEV versus extended range format, I think you're right. I think in some markets we do recognize the lack of infrastructure could be a potential bottleneck for BEV penetration. However, I think these markets, I think currently the BEV penetration is still very low. So there is still ample growth opportunity for BEV models themselves. So we are also very hopeful the growth of BEV exports as well as the market penetration will increase as we expand into more markets. But at the same time, once we actually have extended range products, we think in some markets, particularly for markets like, let's say, Latin America or Central Asia or Middle East, where charging facility infrastructure is lacking for efficient and fast charging BEV products, some of the extended range product will actually be also attractive. So we're actually very, very optimistic that both BEV as well as extended range products will be finding attractive growth opportunities in various global markets.
Thank you, Brian. 那我的第二个问题是关于 这个产能的部分，那因为我们过去几个月已经连续出了两款爆款的产品，那也看到就是小鹏总跟各位领导也是请这个供应商加紧的这个把这个产能零部件的产能提升起来。那想请这个管理层能不能帮我先梳理一下，我们到今年底或者是说明年全年的一个设备的有效产能 大概会到多少？那有没有这个新建工厂的计划？还是说在目前现有的两个工厂的厂区附近，就能够这个增加新的产能？那也可不可以帮我们更新一下这个资本开支？那如果最近还有什么component 有短缺的话，哪一些可能是目前稍微会比较缺，会制约我们的近期的产能？那我也翻译一下我的问题。So my second question is related to capacity. Could you advised your latest capacity and also your effective capacity in 2025. Do you have any plan to expand the new plant or you can just expand your current plant to meet the demand? And recently, do you also see any component shortage across your supply chain? Thank you.
I mean, Charles, first of all, I think as we mentioned in the earnings call that both our Guangzhou and Zhaoqing plant already turned on the second shift. I think each of the plant can support approximately 200,000 to 300,000 per annum based on the two shifts. And also, I think as we communicate before, there are also ample reserved land and also existing the plant.Next to our Guangzhou and Zhaoqing manufacturing base. So we believe that we can expand our production capacity at fast speed and also with low capital intensity. And also we already had our long-term production capacity planning until 2026. And so we believe that all these required manufacturing capacity has been well planned ahead.And also, given we have long-term planning for our own manufacturing capacity, we are also working with our suppliers also to expand the supplier's capacity because, as you know, that we are pushing really hard on the platform, unified platform, and also the components sharing across multi-platforms and vehicles. So it is actually more efficient for our suppliers to expand their capacity with us.
Thank you, Charles.
Thank you. Your next question comes from Bin Wang with Deutsche Bank. Please go ahead.
各位领导好，谢谢您给我这个机会。我第一个问题关于毛利率的细节哈，请问一下三季度跟二季度这毛利率增长2.2%，能不能细分到，比如说多少成本节约，多少是因为组合改善，多少是因为二季度有一个 P5 的一些平常的一些费用带来的，所以呢，能不能量化一下，以及呢，就是对四季度毛利率能否到双位数？好，我翻译一下。My first question is about the gross margin of the vehicles. Actually, in the third quarter, you got 2.2 percentage points much expansion. Can you quantify each of the factors? How much came from the product mix? How much came from cost reduction? How much came from the high base because second quarter have some NOP cost. And secondly, okay, you actually guide for the number four quarter. Do you think the vehicle cost margin can go to double digit or not? Thank you.
Hey, Ben, this is James. So to your question on the Q3 versus Q2 margin improvement, I'd say it's primarily driven by two aspects. One is we continued engineering cost reduction with regard to efforts on VAVE in combination of the battery cost reduction as we see the battery cost is coming down for the entire industry. You didn't mention the EOP impact. We did have some EOP impact in the second quarter, which is less in the third quarter, which is also driving an improvement of the margin. So that's for the quarter-over-quarter improvement. As we look into Q4, we mentioned earlier the P7 Plus delivery will start in Q4. This is a product that will embed our latest platform with the cost reduction targets achieved and representing a double-digit gross margin as we communicated earlier. This is going to help us further improve our vehicle margin from Q3 into Q4. So as a trend, we do see margin continue to improve combined with larger scale. As Xiaopeng mentioned earlier, we expect our Q4 delivery to be exceeding prior quarters in the history, therefore helping us to thin our manufacturing cost as well and improve overall margin.
So can we have a double-digit cost margin in the number four quarter? Possible?
The overall margin will improve. As you can see, we have overall margin in Q3 as reported, and you can expect that to improve in the fourth quarter.
Okay, thank you. 第二个问题呢是有一点想问，最近呢有些新闻报道是 台湾的那个晶片代工商呢可能会不允许代工一些高性能7纳米的芯片，想问问看这个有没有对我们的那个将来提出的芯片有任何的可能性的影响？ The question is that recently media report that a Taiwan foundry company may not able to doing the OEM for China chip suppliers actually for the 7 nanometer. Will this any potential impact for our upcoming chips? Thank you.
Hey, Bing, this is Charles. I think that the mass production of our Turing SoC still progress well, and we haven't seen any impact on our development of the Turing SoC.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Your next question comes from Tina Ho with Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
感谢管理层接受我的提问。我第一个问题是关于这个咱们中长期的一个技术降本的一个路径。如果看未来的，比如说5年到10年，我们持续的有哪些方面可以做到这个技术降本？如果从这个我们的 就ADAS 这块支架的智能座舱，然后支架，然后包括三电系统，包括可能像车身、内外饰各个方面，如果总结起来，您觉得未来的5到10年还有多少的一个成本下降的空间？谢谢，这是我第一个问题。Thanks for taking my question. So my first question is regarding long-term cost reduction of EV. So if we look at it from an angle of the powertrain, the ADAS BOM, including both smart cabin as well as autonomous driving, as well as for maybe potentially the car body and the interior exterior, so how much potential further cost reduction do you think there is in the longer term? Thank you.
说实话，这个问题从我角度来看，也在不断的学习跟成长。大概在一年半前，那么当时我在财报说，在也就是在这个季度，我们期望做到一个比较大的成本的控制。我还是非常开心的是，在那个时候是鼓足勇气说的，但是在现在我们是做到了。那么回过头来，我们来看未来的三年，甚至到四年左右的。 还有哪些降本？我认为从我们现在来看，有非常多的地方还是有能力的。包括了，我认为，除了基础标准上大家所看到的在供应链呐、规模啊、技术啊，我认为未来的降本还有很多类。比如说举例，能不能把一个车进行更大型的超级集成？那么 超级集成可以使很多个零部件的很多部分能力合并，那么能否可以去学习苹果或者部分的厂商能够去帮助 Tier 1， 甚至和 Tier 1 一起看到 Tier 2、 Tier 3， 他们的成本、质量、物流等系列的组合，这个里面实际上有大量的空间。再比如说在电子物料方面，有哪一些的 集约化、统筹规划，我实际上刚才只讲了三四个方向，实际上从我们角度来看呢，可能在成本的控制跟能力提高有7到8个维度的大方向，例如包括制造工艺的巨大能力提高，我觉得这都是作为一家技术创新的公司，在我们未来3到4年里面会不断去 去做，所以在将来的科技日和将来的部分的财报里面，我觉得大家会看到我们每一年的成本控制，我不认为应该来自于仅仅来自于规模和供应链的控制，更多来自于技术的创新
去来的实现。谢谢。
Thank you. Thank you for this question. Actually, we've never stopped thinking about that, and our understanding and our possible solution to it has been changing over the years. I remember about a year and a half ago, during the earnings call, I actually made a promise of achieving significant cost reduction. At that time, I actually summoned my courage to make that promise, and I'm very happy and proud that we're able to actually deliver what we promised at that time. And in the coming 3 to 4 years, obviously, there are a lot of room for improvement when it comes to cost reduction. A lot of things are very obvious, for example, supply chain optimization, scale, economy of scale, and also technology driven kind of cost reduction. But specifically, we can do a lot more things as well. For example, on the one hand, we can do something that we call super integration, meaning that we can actually combine different capabilities of different parts together and make something that is significantly different from what we traditionally have. Or we can also learn and adopt the Apple model, which is to empower the tier one suppliers or help them together develop the capabilities of tier two, tier three suppliers' advantages, leveraging their already existing existent logistic capability and a lot other details that can help us to improve efficiency and cut costs. In addition to that, we also can look at, for example, saving and cost control and in the electric materials, etc. I mean, these are just some examples, tip of iceberg here, really. And as a company that's constantly driven by technology innovation, we also can look at the upgrade of our manufacturing process, our craftsmanship in the coming 3 to 4 years. We're not going to stop until we achieve, you know, the optimal level of cost cutting. Now, in the future AI Tech Day and also in the future earnings call, you can expect to hear our reporting of every year's cost control outcome. And I don't think it's not just going to, I don't think that it will come from only the scale or supply chain control optimization, but more likely being driven by technological innovation. Thank you.
非常感谢小鹏总的回答。然后第二个问题是关于我们2025年的这个新的模型新车型以及可能我们对这个总体销量的有没有一个展望。那车型端我们知道有四款，有没有更加具体一点的分别在哪个季度推出，然后什么样的车型以及什么样的价格段。 And so second question is regarding our 2025 new model pipeline and also volume outlook. Could we get more details in terms of the four new models? Which quarter will they come out? And then what kind of price range, what kind of body type, and also our overall volume outlook for 2025? Thank you.
Hey, Tina, it's Brian. I think, first of all, we are not providing, obviously, annual guidance as we've done in the past. So I think right now, all I can say is that next year we actually are very confident that we can continue the momentum we're seeing the second half of this year, and also looking at the growth profile, I think it will be more moderate growth compared to this year, but still I think it will be second half slightly heavier than the first half. In terms of the model, I think we give you the total number. We're not at the moment, I think, ready to share specific models and exactly when they will be launched. But we mentioned that there will be four new models. One of those will be extended range model. And also in addition to those four models, we will have a few refresh of current models. And that will be spread over the next 4 quarters. So you'll expect to see a new model and refreshment potentially every quarter.
感谢 Brian， 那个很快再 follow up 一下。那对于我们这四个新的 model， 我们的预期应该不会比 Mona 和 P7 价更低吧？ So for the four new models, our expectation should not be lower versus Mona as well as P7 Plus.
Well, I think we are very, very confident that the models we launch will be leading their respective categories. Obviously, different segments and different categories will have different volume expectations, but we do feel like our models will be very competitive in their respective segments.
好的，感谢. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Your next question comes from Nick Lay with JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
好的，谢谢提让我提问题，我是菲菲摩根 Nick。第一个问题是有关出口出海的问题。刚提到说第三季度海外的销售占。在我们的第三季度的销量占15%，但是我们看到大部分的这个主机厂在海外的价格都通常都比较高，它的这个毛利或是单车经理通常是以这个本销一样的车型大概是 1.5到2倍，不晓得这个是不是这个趋势也是符合在小鹏现在看到的状况。那同时间刚小鹏总有提到说在海外的这个以后的新车销售会有跟国内一样这个 SNGP 的 Level 3的这种能力，那在海外的这个消费者他的这个可能他的这个这个消费习惯或他的这个并没有像国内一样这个年轻消费者对这个科技的这个含量这么重视，我们怎么去教育这个海外的消费者这个他们必须要以后要买这个 AI 的汽车，怎么去 educate 这个 customer。 我很快翻译 Let me translate my question very quickly. At the moment, third quarter export overseas market accounted for about 15% of our sales volume, but we understand from other competitors that for those who have overseas exposure, the profitability or profit margin is generally about 1.5 to 2 times higher than the same car sold in China. Is it fair to say the same pattern would apply to export? And likewise, how do we educate overseas customers that level 2, level 3 functionality is something very nice that they need to have in the future?
Hey Nick, it's Brian. I think let me address your first question in terms of overseas markets profitability contribution to us. I think there are a couple areas to think about. One is that yes, in general, I think the price of selling our models overseas are higher than domestic prices. There's additional cost, obviously, and potential tariff and duties that we have to pay. But the margin in general is slightly higher than the domestic gross margin. But also to be mindful is that the margins that we achieve in a lot of these overseas markets actually are margins that wholesale margins, because we are working with importers or distributors in those countries where we are not responsible for retailing and distribution of those products. So a lot of those margins actually, it's essentially direct contribution to us rather than just a gross margin. So that's there's a distinction. But I think going into next year, I think clearly, we are need to dealing with changes in tariff, changing potential new markets, have different regimes. So we need to obviously have a more flexible approach to that structure. But this year, I think the contribution has been pretty positive. And I think Xiaopeng addressed your second question.
对，第二个问题，实际上我们的确看到，但当然海外呢，分为很多个不同的国家，在欧洲跟中国的确有很大的差别。那么比如说包括用户，中国的用户偏年轻，那么欧洲的用户呢会偏中年以上。那么所以对智能化或者说对于科技的看法，在中国跟欧洲之间实际上是有很大的差异，但在中国跟部分其他的国家还有很大的趋同性。那我先回到中国跟欧洲，我相信从欧洲角度来看，我们认为啊，智能化的座舱、超高速的充电和智能化的服务售后加运营，以及在自动泊车和标准的 LCC、ACC 可能是他们目前在智能化上感受最典型的。但是在中国的当前城市类的自动辅助驾驶，因为受限于法规跟很多的条例，我相信可能会比中国大概还要再晚12个月甚至多一点点。但是实际上我们相信如果做好硬件和做好软件的 ready，在不同的国家我们会有不同的智能化的组合，那这些组合会让小鹏的高端品牌科技差异会做得更强。所以我对于智能化将来的核心在于运营，会不断的在统一标准的车型里面提高，提供更强力的智能化，并且在全球走得更好，我是非常有信心的。从我们的数据正在快速的看到这一点，谢谢。
Thank you.
Yes, indeed. Different countries are different. They have different users, different preferences, different regulations. By comparison, for example, Europe versus China, typically China, you know, as a market, has a younger group of consumers that are, you know, really attracted by NEVs, whereas in Europe, the majority of the users are middle-aged and above. But also, we see a lot of similarities between China and other parts of the world outside of EU as well. But here, for this discussion, I'm going to focus on the differences between Europe and China. Now, right now, what you know, when it comes to the capabilities being delivered to our Europe's customers, I think they really love smart cabin, fast and ultra-fast efficient charging, our high-quality services, after-sales services, and also the valet parking, auto parking, LCC, ACC. These are the, you know, sort of most daily commonly accepted and preferred ADAS features that are being loved by European customers. And when it comes to other parts of ADAS features, because of the limitation or because of the regulatory environment in Europe, typically, you know, the implementation of those features in Europe is about 12 months behind what we can see in China right now. But as a company that is being driven by technology with heavy investment and very strong capabilities in software and hardware, we are very, very confident in, you know, adopting the same set of solutions, but using different combinations for different market in order to build our global presence as a premium brand going forward. And right now, you know, as has been proven by market feedback, that we are actually able to do that. So in the future, when it comes to landing or implementing our solutions in different countries, we're going to focus more on not only product and service quality, but also the operations across different regions to customize for local consumers. Thank you.
好的，谢谢。我第二个问题比较简单，也是有关你这个政策的一个旧换新的问题。那这个问题就从 top down 来看的话，旧换新的政策明年不晓得小鹏总预期这个政策持续性的可信可能性有多高？那同时间因为我们目前的销售量，Mona 3还有这个 PC Plus 销售量非常好。那目前来看的话，在现状就要去订单的话，交车可能都要到明年一二月份才交车了。 那就公司在这部分，假设客户现在下定到明年才能拿到车子的话，这部分在补贴或者在行销的这个策略上面有一些想法，可以提供参考。My second question is really about the trading policy. From top-down standpoint, what's our view on the continuity of the policy into 25? And likewise, our product sales volume has been very strong, especially for Mona 3 and PC Plus. If we place orders today, and we only get a car sometime in first quarter next year. And what's our marketing strategy for the customer who get a car only in first quarter? Thanks.
Hi, Nick, this is Charles. I think we believe that our newly launched product like MO3 and also the P7 Plus are very competitive in terms of the product capabilities. And I think that the customer chose the product because I think there's no alternative product or less, or very limited options available to them in the price range. So we believe that we will continue to see the strong momentum for the orders for the MO3 and also P7 Plus. I think that more importantly, I think that we have very significant, significant order backlog for both MO3 and the P7 Plus. I think this is also very different from a lot of our peers. We will be carrying probably tens of thousands order backlog for both MO3 and the P7 Plus into the Q1. So we believe that that will be a foundation of our growth in 2025.
Thanks. 那个 Charles， 我的问题是说，就是假设客户现在下订，他明年才拿到车的话，这个假设明年旧换新的这个补贴会被取消的话，公司会不会考虑在补贴客户这一部分？My question is aside from that, thanks Charles. My question is for the customer who buy PC Plus, P7 Plus or Mona 3, if they only get a car in first quarter 2025, will XPeng consider reimburse them, provide additional incentive? Thanks.
Hi, this is Alex. So first of all, we do not have any specific insight about the government subsidies. We expect that the auto sector will still be supported by any of the potential stimulus policy is a priority of any of the economic policy. And regarding the customer expectations, I think they have quite reasonable expectations for the delivery time. As you can see, the delivery time for the P7 Plus is 8 to 11 weeks. So I don't think our customers, they are expecting to see sort of delivery before the December of this year. For most of the customers who put their orders right now, they have reasonable expectations. We don't think they will change the decision because of the subsidies. They chose XPeng cars because of the unique value proposition we bring to these customers in these segments, P7 Plus, more than 03. They exceeded the competitiveness of all our peers' models. So we don't really expect to see a material impact from any potential continuation or discontinuation of subsidies. We just focus on our product competitiveness as well as strengthening our channels.
Thanks, very, very clear. Thank you.
Thank you. As there are no further questions now, I'd like to turn the call back over to the company for closing remarks.
Thank you once again for joining us today. If you have further questions, please feel free to contact XPeng's investor relations through the contact information provided on our website or the Pearson Financial Communications.
This concludes today's conference call. You may now disconnect your line. Thank you.